The Covenant partners and friends welcome you to Voice of Joy Word Ministries. Voice of Joy is a family church, a training center, and a restoring body. We are called to cover the earth with total man ministry. Now for today's message.
Your mercy never fails me. Yes. My name is Coronet Fuller. I'm a member of VOJ Word Ministries. And tonight, I will minister and hopefully impart some insight into the fruit of the Spirit. And the fruit of the Spirit that I'm ministering on tonight is love. The greatest fruit that nourishes the Spirit. It's an ingredient that fuels the Spirit. Love abides, love sustains. Galatians 5:22-23 says, "But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, forbearance, kindness, and goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control. Against such there is no law." We know that things start or begin in the mind. So once it's imparted into the mind, it is digested into the heart. And after it's digested into the heart, it is represented through an action. And love is the greatest gift of believers. Without the gift of love, we can't say that we are a believer. Scripture also tells us in John 15:3 that greater love has no man than this, that one lay down his life for a friend. And if we speak that we have love, we are just making noise. Scripture also tells us that we are as tinkling cymbals. So we're not producing anything, we're just making noise. We're busybodies. I've taken a moment to digest this thing called love because it's nourishment to the Spirit. I have placed some fruit. This fruit, each has its individual characteristics. The characteristics of an orange is different from the characteristics of a peach. The characteristics of a peach is different from the characteristic of an apple. It's all nourishing, but they each have their own distinct characteristics and contributions to the body. Also, when you look at bread, and those of you who know me know that I'm a baker, and you look at the ingredients of bread, there's a leavening agent that changes the characteristics of the bread and yields the product that you are seeking to accomplish. A bread that requires yeast has just a little pinch of yeast placed into the dough. But it changes the characteristics of all of the other ingredients and yields a product distinct to that yeast that was placed in that dough. The same for a cake. It requires baking powder. The same for cookies. Cookies require baking soda. Each of those are leavening agents, but they each have their own yielding characteristic. The same is true with love. As we look through the scriptures, we find many, many, many types of love. So I will tell you about four of those types of love. There are several, but I'm going to touch on four of those types of love. And they're each individual in their yielding contribution. 1 Corinthians 13:4 through 7 tells us that love is patient, love is kind. It does not envy, it does not boast, it is not proud, it does not dishonor others. It is not self-seeking, it is not easily angered, it keeps no record of wrongdoing. Love does not delight in evil, but rejoices in the truth. It always protects, it always trusts, and it always hopes, always perseveres. Love is relationship. So the first love that I will introduce to you is storge. And that's empathetic love. That's the love between a mother and a child. It's the love between relatives. It's a family bond type of love. I know many of us grew up in families where there may have been rivalries among siblings. There may have been rivalries among siblings, but let someone from the outside come in and try to infiltrate that family. And they become a unit, they become a bond. And that's what storge love is. One of the best examples of storge love is Noah. When he built the ark, he had his wife, his sons, and his daughter-in-laws. And they all came into the ark of safety. Another example is Martha and Mary and their love for their brother Lazarus. They were even upset when they felt that Jesus had denied them the access of still having their brother alive. That's a family bond. Also, it is a profound example shown between the sons Cain and Abel. I'm sure they started out as children, playing, loving each other, enjoying each other, having children fun. But then they grew up and their love took a turn. So this is an example of love taking a turn that started out as storge and then became envy, hate, and ultimately led to the death of Abel by his own brother, Cain. Philia. Philia love is that friend love. That friend that you can confide in, that shares the same interests, that contributes to the nourishment of the characters of each individual involved. John 15:3 again states, greater love has no man than this, that someone lay down his life for his friend. We see filial love exemplified between Elijah and Elisha. Elijah had a gift, Elisha desired it. So he made up his mind that he would follow him no matter where he went. He followed him, and sure enough, at the end he saw him taken up and he received his double portion. Sometimes it requires that you stay on the focus of what you are determined to do and let nothing distract you. Another example is the love between Ruth and Naomi. Ruth was the daughter-in-law of Naomi. Naomi's sons were killed. She gave them instructions that they could disperse, go wherever they wanted to. But Ruth decided that she would stay with her friend Naomi. She stuck with her through the end, and ultimately, she prevailed. Elizabeth and Mary. Elizabeth and Mary had a bond that even excited the children in their wombs. When Elizabeth saw Mary, her baby leaped. Now that's a strong, strong friendship that extends even into the wombs of your being. Abraham and Isaac. Abraham and Isaac had the relationship of father and son, but there was a commandment from God for Abraham to sacrifice his son Isaac. Abraham was obedient. Friendships sometimes require you to do things that sort of test you. So Abraham decided, okay, I'm going to follow God at all costs. And yes, he did take Isaac to be sacrificed. But at the very end, his friend, his older brother Jesus, came through for him. And as he came through for him, It's thought that Abraham believed God over his own feelings, over his own thoughts, over his own supposed needs at that time. So he was called a friend of God in James 2:21 and 23. Out of all the loves, friendship seems to be the happiest, although sometimes it does test you. But through experience and relationship, you learn to persevere. The third type of love is the romantic love, eros. Eros is loving someone, a being in love. It is the passionate love, the love between a man and a woman. We see that exemplified in 2 Samuel 11:2. There, David was caught by the eye of Bathsheba. Bathsheba was bathing in a window. He went up on the rooftops. He saw this beautiful being, and he felt he had to have her. He had to have her even at the cost of sacrificing her own husband. Eros love. Sometimes it leads to good, sometimes it leads to bad. Another example is the love of Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. Adam was put to sleep, and from his being was formed a woman. Genesis 3:23 says that the man said, "This is now bone of my bones and flesh of my flesh. She shall be called woman, and she shall be taken out of man." A lot of us make jokes and say that Adam just didn't say woman, but he said, "Whoa, man," because she was such a beautiful being. She caught his eye. That's Eros love. The last love, the one that is most profound, that is supposed to be definitely exemplified among Christian beings, is agape love. Agape love is the unconditional love of God, sometimes referred to as charity, because it also requires an action. It requires you to do something, regardless of your situation or circumstance. Exemplifying agape love requires something of you. An example of agape love is shown in the prodigal son. There were two brothers. The younger brother decided that he would consider his father dead, and he asked for his inheritance. His father gave it to him. He received his inheritance, he went away, he squandered it, he destroyed his life level standards. But one day he came to himself, and when he came to himself, he felt that I could always go back to my father's house. He knew how he had left his father's house. He left his father's house as though he had considered his father dead. But his father had that unconditional love. When he saw his son, his lost son, his son that had considered him dead, he looked beyond that and he ran to meet him. He placed upon his finger a very expensive ring. He placed upon his body beautiful, expensive rings. And he threw a block party like nothing else. He invited all of the people in the countryside. "Come, come, let's celebrate. The son that was lost has now been found." That's what Jesus does for us. He rejoices over the one that strays away. He doesn't look at the circumstances or the situation at which we strayed away, but he looks at the fact that we come to ourselves and we find our way back. Another example of unconditional love is Hosea and Gomer. Gomer was a harlot. Hosea was obedient. He was instructed to take her as his wife, and he did. What an awesome, awesome exemplification of agape love. He loved God. He loved Jesus. He gave up his rights. And sometimes what we feel is our rights is not in the plan of God, because we are supposed to live in this earth to glorify God through our living, to glorify God through our loving, to glorify God in everything that we do, everything we say. We're supposed to really be the epitome of God in the earth. Some says that there are some love that doesn't require commitment, but every love requires some type of commitment. Even the love that we have no choice in, which is storage. We don't have a choice in what family we are born into. We don't have a choice in who our siblings will be. We don't even have a choice in who our parents are going to be. But when we are born into that unit, you become familiar with every single person in that unit, and you become concerned about each and every one. Another example of agape love is shown in our lives today. When we give up the world and we come into the fold of Christ, we decide that there's nothing in the world that we need. Because Jesus said that he is your supplier. He will supply every one of your needs according to his riches in glory through Christ Jesus. So we need to look at all of these loves one more time. We need agape love because some of the things God requires of us are not fun or easily, but they need to be done. What does God require of us today? If he requires it of us, we should seek by any means necessary to accomplish it. And that is the greatest satisfaction that God can get from us through our act of love. We need filial love because we are supposed to replenish the earth. And the only way that the earth can be replenished is through the union of a man and a woman. That relationship yields the fruit that replenishes the earth. And it is deeply rooted, it is deeply grounded in commitment. That was Eros love. Now we look at that perfect love that surpasses all understanding, that love to Jesus, the love of Jesus. Looking to God, the author and the finisher of our faith, let us continue to walk, let us continue to talk, let us continue to exemplify that gift of love that God has called you to be in, whether it's in a marriage, whether it's with a deep companion, a friend, a confidant, whether it is in a family. We should always think, how can I sacrifice myself to make sure this relationship exemplifies Christ? Agape love stands when all other loves have failed. Agape love is the universal love that is shared among Christians. Let us pray. Lord God, we thank you for this time today. We thank you that you've allowed us and allotted us an opportunity to show forth the ingredient found in the fruit of the Spirit, love. That ingredient that changes our entire being, that ingredient that yields a most satisfying result, a result in knowing that we have pleased you. So we thank you today, we praise you today, we honor you today, we glorify you today, because you alone are Lord, and you showed us the greatest love of all. in John 3:16. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him shall not perish, but have everlasting life. I thank you. And as our bishop would always say, this has been my time, and I thank you for me.
I know you were blessed by that powerful message tonight. Take the time to share it with someone. And now it's opportunity time. This is the time where we give to the Lord. The scripture declares in Luke 6:38, give and it shall be given unto you, good measure, pressed down, shaken together, and running over shall men give into your bosoms. For with the same measure that you meet withal, it shall be measured to you again. So take the time out and give tonight. Be a blessing. Amen. I know that you've received something good that you can take through your week. All right, so we have several fields of giving. We have first fruit giving, and that's our best, our first, our highest seed. All right, and then we have tithes and offerings. We can give into our missions, our building fund. We have step out seed, Solomon seed. I tell you, many fields to give in, all to the glory of God. You're giving into good ground tonight. So we thank you for sowing. You can go to vojword.com and go to our Givelify app and click on the link. It'll be a simple process. Thank you so much for sowing into VOJ Word. And now we're going to pray with that seed. Father, I thank you. Thank you, Lord God, for those that have given tonight, Lord. And we thank you, Father God, for multiplying the seed sown, Lord. Thank you for the things that they're standing for, God. And we call them done tonight in the name of Jesus. Lord, we give you the glory and the praise. Hallelujah. You're tuning in this streaming opportunity and you don't know the Lord. We want to offer you that opportunity. I tell you, God wants you in his family. He loves you so much, for he so loved this world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Come on into the family of God. It's simple. Hallelujah. God made it so easy. Glory to God. Romans 10:9-10 says, if you confess with your mouth the Lord Jesus and believe in your heart that God has raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. Hallelujah. For with the heart man believeth unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. Come on, just say, Father, I need you in my life. I'm tired of living the way I've been living. Lord, save me. Help me tonight, Lord. I believe that you raised Jesus from the dead, and I want to be, Lord God, with you. I want to be with the family of God. If you said that in sincerity tonight, then God has done it in you. You are saved. Hallelujah. Share it with someone. Amen. Hallelujah. I tell you, heaven is rejoicing right now when one person comes in. Hallelujah. And I'm rejoicing with heaven. God bless you tonight. Thank you so much for joining us. We bless you. Father, we thank you for your people, Lord. Thank you, Father God, for ministering life for a prosperous and wonderful week. We give you the glory and we give you all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. Thank you so much for streaming in tonight.